In April 1967, Ron Jones, a high school teacher in Palo Alto, taught a history lesson. The topic of study was Nazi Germany. The lesson went according to plan until one of the students asked, how could the Germans pretend they knew nothing about the concentration camps and the atrocities of the Nazis? Why did people who were neighbors and even friends of Jewish families turn a blind eye to the Holocaust? The question perplexed the teacher, and since the class was ahead of the curriculum, Jones decided to conduct an experiment to explain the phenomenon. In the new episode of Histographics, we're going to tell you what Ron Jones' experiment called the Third Wave led to. The teacher began the first day of the experiment by creating an optimal learning environment, starting by giving a speech about the power of discipline. In vivid and imaginative terms, he spoke about the feelings of an athlete who trained hard to become the best, how persistently the artist works, achieving the perfect strokes on the canvas, and how many hours the ballerina spent in the hall so that all her movements were striking in their lightness. The teacher spoke about the boundless tenacity of the scientist seeking to prove his ideas. To show this in practice, he told the disciples to sit at attention after the bell, because according to him, this is the only way to concentrate and gather will. The ideal position was as follows: legs flat on the floor, the feet are parallel, the ankles are tense, the knees are at right angles, and the arms are crossed and folded. The back is straight, the chin is slightly lowered, the head is slightly forward. Jones ordered the whole class over and over to get up and then sit down in a new position. He continuously walked between the rows, pointing out minor flaws. Pretty quickly, teenagers learned this. Then the teacher drove everyone into the corridor from where they had to quickly enter and sit down in their places. All exercises took place in complete silence. After several attempts, the whole class silently entered the office and sat down in just 5 seconds. Then the usual lesson began. However, now all questions and answers of the student had to start with the address, Mr. Jones. The teacher demanded that the remarks consist of 2 or 3 words, and before speaking, the student must stand near the desk. Suddenly, everyone liked the lesson. The students enthusiastically tried to complete the assignments. The whole class, including even passive students, showed great interest in the process. The next day, when Jones entered the classroom, he found that the students were silently sitting at attention. And although some were smiling, most were as focused as possible. Jones decided to make the class a group of like-minded people with the highest levels of discipline. He announced the creation of a new movement, Third Wave. The name came from sailors' belief that during a storm, it is the third wave that is the strongest. The teacher emphasized the main idea of the movement in the motto, strength through discipline, strength through community, strength through action, strength through pride. The children enthusiastically chanted the slogan, feeling growing cohesion in the class. Jones then demonstrated a third wave greeting. The right arm was bent and lifted to the left shoulder. He ordered this greeting to be used when meeting even outside the audience. On Wednesday, the experiment took on a life of its own. The entire school took part in it. Students from other classes who had free time between classes came to Jones's lesson. From 30 people, the class increased to 43. Everyone happily exchanged new greetings. All students showed an increase in motivation and consequently significantly improved their knowledge of the subject. Jones handed the students membership cards and gave everyone a personal assignment. For example, design a traffic banner or keep outsiders outside the community out of the classroom. He marked 3 tickets with red crosses. Their owners had to report everyone who did not follow the new rules. To Jones's surprise, half of the class became volunteer informants. The teacher gave instructions on how to recruit new members, and by the end of the day, the movement had over 200 members. Many of them took the experiment too seriously. They demanded strict adherence to the rules from other students, and also threatened those who did not take the movement seriously. One of the worst students was a young man named Robert. He was distinguished by a large physique, but did not stand out at all among the students and did not show any ability to learn. The only reason Jones remembered Robert at all was that the student always dined alone in class. Late in the evening, the teacher found the boy stalking him. Smiling for the first time ever, Robert said to the teacher, "Mr. Jones, I'm your bodyguard. I'm afraid something might happen to you." However, not everyone showed such loyalty. There were 3 girls in the class with the highest academic performance. They were friends with each other and really enjoyed their studies. Under the new conditions, their academic knowledge ceased to carry weight. They were suppressed by the changed reality. The students shared the experience with their parents, and they told the local rabbi. The teacher informed him that the class was studying the Nazi personality type. The rabbi was satisfied with the answer, and he promised to explain everything to his parents. As Jones recalled at the time of the conversation, he thought about similar cases from world history when representatives of the clergy calmly accepted the incredible conditions and even apologized for them. If the rabbi got angry or simply showed more interest in the third wave, he would become an example of caring. But he turned into another participant in the experiment, essentially defending the neo-Nazi movement out of his ignorance. Jones did not meet any resistance from adults either. Moreover, the headmaster and librarian also began to use the third wave greeting, which upset him very much. The teacher was faced with a dilemma: to finish the experiment or to continue. Both options seemed bad. If Jones suddenly ceases to exist third wave, then many students, especially those who've gained confidence in themselves, would find themselves in a deplorable state. They've opened up to others, have shown their penchant for radical views, and the return to reality would be painful. But there could be no talk of a continuation. Late in the evening, someone organized a pogrom in the history office. The next morning, Jones found the intruder waiting for him at the door to the auditorium. It turned out to be the father of one of the schoolchildren, a retired Air Force colonel who was captured during the war. Hearing about the experiment, he lost control. The man told the teacher about what he went through. From surprise and frustration, he spoke incoherently and was not even able to walk home. As Jones feared, the experiment was completely out of control. More and more schoolchildren joined the movement, and their devotion turned into fanaticism. The line between role play and conscious behavior had finally disappeared. The size of the class doubled. Now there were 80 people in the classroom. Jones's bodyguard followed him relentlessly, not even leaving the teacher's room, where schoolchildren were not allowed to enter. And the author of the experiment himself felt that he was entering the role of a leader even when it was not necessary. Jones decided to take the initiative back into his own hands and end the experiment. In front of the whole class, he gave a fiery speech. "Pride is not only about flags and greetings," he said. "Pride is something that no one can take away from you. Being proud means knowing that you are the best. Pride cannot be destroyed." Jones said their movement is part of a national program to find students who are committed to political change in the country. His speech began to resemble the leader of the Third Reich in intonations. "Everything we did was just preparation," Jones continued to say. "Across America, educators are recruiting youth teams to demonstrate to the nation that a better society can be created. If we are able to establish a new order in our school, then we can change factories, shops, and all other organizations. You are the chosen ones who can help us in this. If you stand up and show what you've learned this week, we will rewrite the fate of our nation. It all depends on you and your willingness to come forward." Jones selected four boys from the class, appointed them as guards, and ordered three female students out of the classroom who were not loyal enough to the movement. He ordered them escorted to the library and not allowed them to return to class. In conclusion, Jones dramatically announced that on Friday at 12 p.m., the third wave would become a real political force. "This will be announced on TV by the new presidential candidate." Simultaneously with his performance, more than 1,000 youth groups in all states will express support for the movement. The teacher ordered all members of the movement to attend this significant event and show themselves in all their glory, because he invited the press. Jones expected laughter or objections, but instead felt the class get excited. Someone asked if they should wear festive clothes. Someone asked permission to bring their friends. And one student literally presented the teacher with a decisive argument showing the latest issue of the Time magazine. It was an advertisement for a timber supplier calling their product the Third Wave. The slogan, "The Third Wave is Approaching," was written in multicolored letters on the entire spread of the magazine. When asked if this was some kind of code, Jones nodded. He told everyone, "Come to the hall at 11:15. Don't tell anyone about the upcoming performance." Jones had been preparing the meeting room all Friday morning. At 11:30, the first students began to arrive, and by the appointed time, there was no free space. About 200 people were packed into the room. The banners of the third wave were hung everywhere. Jones invited his friends, who acted as photographers and reporters, to take group pictures and left notes in notebooks. Jones noticed that the audience consisted of different school communities: athletes, school leaders, hippies, club members. Even lone outsiders and constant truants came. However, the crowd was one, as all attention was focused on the television from where the promised new leader was about to appear. Jones stood in front of them and announced, that before the start of the national press conference, he wanted to show the press the extent of the preparation for the movement. He gave a salute, and the whole crowd threw up their hands at the same time. He loudly pronounced, "Strength through discipline," and the disciples repeated after him, louder and louder. The photographers never stopped filming this ritual. The last time Jones asked for dedication to the third wave, and the room shuddered with a shout, "Strength through discipline." There was a tense silence. Jones turned off the lights in the audience and walked over to the TV. Only the test chart flickered on the screen, accompanied by a steady noise. For several minutes, the audience peered at her. On their faces, the expectation gave way to anxiety, then disappointment. Then the teacher addressed everyone. "There is no leader or national movement. You were manipulated. You were pushed by your own ambitions. And in the end, this is where you ended up. You are no different from the Germans we talked about. You have traded freedom for the comfort of discipline and a sense of superiority. You preferred the will of the group and total lies to your own convictions. You think you came here for fun and you can stop at any time. But what is your goal? How far could you go? Now you will see your future." Jones set up the projector and turned on a movie about the Third Reich. Everyone silently looked at the parades and the crowd adoring the Führer, at the horrific shooting of concentration camps and interrogations of the Germans, who made excuses that they simply did what they were ordered to do. The teacher continued, "If you were able to copy the mentality of the Nazis, then none of you will tell the others that you attended this meeting. Just like the Germans, you will not be able to admit that you have come this far." The stunned students dispersed in silence. Bodyguard Jones, like many, couldn't hold back tears. The teacher was right. Out of shame, most of the students didn't tell anyone about their participation in the third wave. The experiment was only briefly mentioned in two articles of the local newspaper. Jones himself published a detailed article on this in the late 1970s and then wrote a book. His story attracted a lot of attention. There were several adaptations of the experience, and in 2011, the documentary Lesson Plan was shot in the USA, which included in-depth interviews with former students of Jones. What do you think? If this experiment were carried out today, would the result change? Or is a person of any era psychologically inclined to submit to a strong leader? Write your opinion in the comments, and don't forget to like, share the video with your friends, and subscribe. We'll see you next time.